Good evening, and welcome to the Fall 2020 Lecture Series at the USS Silverside Submarine Museum in Muskegon, Michigan. For the last 8 years, our program has been presented in front of a live audience in our beautiful Channel B room overlooking our two historic vessels moored in Muskegon Channel, a short distance from Lake Michigan. Due to COVID restrictions this fall, we must present virtually, and we are happy to welcome our wonderful patrons with whom we see each week and our new friends joining us tonight for the first time. The World Transformed 1945 to 1953 is a topic of our 10-week series. Over the next few weeks, we'll explore topics related to the conclusion of World War II, the beginning of the Cold War, and the Korean conflict. This small portion of history has always intrigued me. After winning the most extensive war in world history, we became quickly embroiled in the Cold War and in Korea. While seeing our military help countless people and nations attempting to rebuild after the destruction of World War II. Tonight's program is being sponsored by the Lorraine F. Birch and Fred S. Birch Foundation, whose mission is to promote public service at the community, state, and local levels through education. Fred and Lori are West Michigan natives who both served their country in the Navy during World War II, and then after the war, the couple continued to put public service at the forefront of their lives. Additionally, our media sponsor is Blue Lake Public Radio. The mission of the USS Silverside Submarine Museum is simply to honor the men and women of the United States military, and we do this through education and preservation. Our program tonight is one aspect of our educational program. The USS Silversides has been bringing military history to life through our lecture series since 2012. Each year, the museum presents approximately 25 lectures on military history. In addition to our lecture series, we offer a large range of STEM and history courses for young people. Our classes give young people a better understanding of how a submarine works and the stories of the brave men and women of the United States military. In addition to our educational programs, we preserve two historic military vessels and countless artifacts that not only tell the story of military history, but the story of the men and women who served. If you have enjoyed tonight's programming, please consider making a donation to the museum so that we may continue to provide quality programming and preservation of our artifacts. The USS Silverside Submarine Museum is a 501c3 corporation that does not receive any state, federal, or local funding. We rely solely on the admissions and donations. Please go to our website to learn more. We'll hear tonight from Fred Johnson. Fred is an associate professor of history at Hope College in Holland, Michigan. Prior to his career in higher education, he served in the United States Marine Corps. He holds a doctorate from Kent State University. Without further ado, welcome to Professor Johnson.
Hello, my name is Fred Johnson. I'm associate professor of history at Hope College. And it's my pleasure to be presenting to you the first of a series of presentations dealing with the Cold War. This is part one, From Certain Victory to Uncertain Peace. It's always seemed to me that the best way to start talking about the Cold War, particularly as the Cold War began in Europe, is to go back to that part of World War II, which was a major turning point, a major bad turning point for Nazi Germany. That would have been June 22nd, 1941, when Hitler sent his forces across the Soviet frontier in Operation Barbarossa, the Nazi invasion of the Soviet Union. It was a brutal fight. Because Joseph Stalin had been so brutal to his people during the 1930s, and because the Soviet army was so unprepared, the Nazi forces were able to make a lot of progress, and they eventually got straight to the gates of Moscow. As you can see from this map showing Nazi occupation of Europe in 1942, the city of Leningrad was under siege and Nazi forces were just outside of Moscow. When you look at a map like this, there is no way to conclude that the Russians were doing any good against the Nazis. And more than that, you see poor England, which is hanging out there by itself. Sweden is neutral, Switzerland is neutral, and Spain was also a fascist country, so it was not involved in World War II. So by any stretch of the imagination, this map tells us that Nazi Germany was not just winning, but succeeded in a very fantastic way. But the thing about going into the Soviet Union that eventually proved to be so costly for the Germans was that as they got deeper and deeper inside of the Soviet Union, Soviet forces pulled back more and more, deeper, ever so deeper, until finally the Nazis, their supply lines were overextended, their forces were logistically at risk, and of course, there was always the Russian winter. Not to mention, there was the Russian people. People like Ludmila Pavlichenko here, a Ukrainian sniper. She had 309 confirmed kills during the war. She was the most successful female sniper in history. Then there were these people. They made up part of the Russian partisans. Interestingly enough, when the Nazis first came to some Soviet towns and villages, they were greeted as liberators because Joseph Stalin was such a monster himself that people thought the Nazis coming into Russia, they were coming there to get rid of Joseph Stalin. But it didn't take long at all for the Nazis to prove that they too were being led by a murderer. And the Russian people eventually gathered themselves together, formed partisan groups, and they began whittling away in constant attacks at those overextended Nazi supply lines. And then as you can see from these very, very grim-faced soldiers of the Red Army, gradually things began to turn around. But it was at that battle at a place called Stalingrad that ended on February 1943, where the Nazi advance was finally stopped. And all one has to do is take a look at the pictures of these Nazi prisoners, these German prisoners of war, to let you know that they knew that they had fallen into a very difficult situation. The dreams of glory and victory that had been echoed from the Reichstag after Hitler took power, there was none of that to be found in these pictures. These are just soldiers who were tired, weary, hungry, and scared. With that victory, and after having about 2 or 3 years of constant pummeling, the big three, that would be Franklin Delano Roosevelt of the United States, Winston Churchill of Great Britain, and Joseph Stalin, they finally had an opportunity now to start putting a heavy hammer to the Nazis. Of course, there was still a war going on in the Pacific, and the British and the Americans were taking the brunt of that against the Japanese. But Hitler was not through yet. He ordered more troops into the Soviet Union. And then when his generals were trying to get him to retreat, he refused, telling them in many instances to fight to the last man, to fight to the death, and also ignoring their call for supplies and proper equipment to beat off the Soviet winter. It just wasn't going to happen. For his part, Joseph Stalin had spent the first part of the war, the better part of the war, asking for Churchill and Franklin Roosevelt to open up a second front. Stalin had always been of the opinion that the Western Allies were letting the Germans do their dirty work for them to get rid of the socialist state. So he kept on pressing and asking over and over and over again for a second front. Now, Winston Churchill had said something about attacking the soft underbelly of Europe, and there was an invasion of Italy, and Stalin was not satisfied with that. He wanted them to show that they were going to do something to take the pressure off the Soviet people who had just been savaged by German forces for the better part of the war. That event came on June 6, 1944, with the Allied landing on D-Day at Normandy, the largest air, sea, amphibious landing ever in history. You can see here the ships going across the channel, the barrage balloons, these landing craft, British, American, Canadian forces, the combined might of the world. It was called Operation Overlord, the liberation of Europe, not the liberation of France, but the liberation of Europe, the liberation of a continent. It must have been truly amazing to see all that combined might and strength of so many nations and so many people dedicated to one task, getting rid of the thuggery and the tyranny of Nazi Germany. Initially, the landing was very difficult, as you can probably imagine, but the Allied forces did establish a beachhead and eventually made their way inland. But the Nazis were not through. They had a few tricks up their sleeve. And one of them, on D plus 7, or D-Day plus 7, they unleashed on June 13, 1944. It was called the V-1 Buzz Bomb. The V-1 was a bomb, a flying bomb. Today we might call it a stupid bomb, not a smart weapon, like a cruise missile. But basically, it was a ramjet that was sent over England. And usually, the British people know when they heard the engine stop that something terrible was about to happen.
In 1942, the Luftwaffe, aware of the development of a long-range rocket by the German army, began intensive development of a rival weapon, a ramjet flying bomb. The flying bomb entered service ahead of the army's rocket and became known as the V-1. Launched from ramps situated in the Pas-de-Calais, flying bombs were used to attack London in an offensive that commenced on June the 13th, 1944. Basically simple in design, the flying bomb was an economical and effective weapon of war. Traveling at speeds of up to 440 miles per hour, it severely tested the air defenses of England. In early September 1944, the flying bomb launch sites were overrun by advancing Allied armies. In a three-month offensive, the bombs killed over 5,000 Londoners, maiming and wounding many thousands more.
As you can tell from that video, these were what people were calling terror weapons. But the Nazis didn't stop there. They also developed a larger weapon of terror called the V-2 rocket that they also started launching against England, London in particular. And these two just fell in civilian areas, just killing people indiscriminately. At this point in the war, the Germans don't really have all that much offensive power yet left. So they're using these terror weapons to try and hang on as best they can. As you can see here from this photo of London, England, destroyed by either V-1 buzz bombs or V-2 rockets, and here in Chiswick. The horror that was coming from the sky sent by the Germans was still not enough to stave off, to delay, to escape the retribution that was surely coming for Adolf Hitler and his henchmen. As well, the same could be said for Benito Mussolini, the fascist dictator and ally, the fascist dictator of Italy and ally of Hitler. And in the Pacific, the Japanese were led by Hideki Tojo. This map right here, showing the advance across Germany from March 23rd through May 8th, 1945, gives a good representation of just how successful both American and Russian forces were. You see coming from the east, going west, the Russian forces that front line from Stettin to Breslau and then further south, and then American, Canadian, British, and US forces that are all heading east, and the convergence point, everybody's trying to get to Berlin. There was a very wonderful meeting on the Elbe River between American forces and Russian forces on April 25th, 1945. These pictures demonstrate just exactly how jubilant these troops were. They were finally united together in a common effort, both Russians and Americans, to defeat their common enemy. And for a moment, it must have seemed like really the world was going to be such a better place after they could finally put World War II to bed. This famous photo right here of a Soviet soldier hanging a Russian flag or a communist flag out over a building in Berlin. And these Soviet soldiers marching through the streets of Berlin looking very triumphant indeed. The political cartoonists always seem to get this right. And in this one you see the Grim Reaper carrying Adolf Hitler's body into hell behind the God of War. As well as things were going for the Allies, there were still some things that threw the alliance into disarray every now and then. And that thing that threw the alliance into disarray just for a moment, was that on April 12, 1945, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, the American president, died in Warm Springs, Georgia. Franklin Delano Roosevelt occupies a space as one of America's great presidents. We've had a lot of great presidents, but he certainly was one of the greatest, having led the country through the Depression and through World War II. But now, time had claimed Roosevelt's presence for eternity, and taking his place was his vice president, Harry S. Truman from Missouri. Now, the big three included Truman, Churchill, and Stalin. On May 7, 1945, General Alfred Jodl surrendered in a ceremony in Reims, France, to the Western Allies. The following day, on May 8, 1944, the senior Nazi commanders surrendered to the Russians in Berlin. This is Field Marshal Keitel. And with that, World War II was over. Of course, there was great celebration. One can only imagine that people could not probably believe that it was finally, once and for all, truly over. It had changed everything. I'm reminded sometimes that World War II touched every aspect of everybody's life, the same way this pandemic has touched every aspect of our lives. Another great big challenge that people just had to not complain about, not worry about, just live through it, fight through it to victory. And indeed, they did fight through to ultimate victory. As you can see from this New York Times headline, the war in Europe is ended. Surrender is unconditional. Clearly it was. The Allies had sustained, they had achieved a major victory, a total victory, a complete victory, and there were no conditions to be allowed. Germany was done. But for the United States, there was still the problem of Japan. The Japanese were still fighting very difficult, very hard, that is, in the Pacific region. And one of the things that the Japanese unleashed toward the end of World War II was a weapon that they referred to as kamikaze, which translated into English means divine wind. Japanese pilots, if you can call them that, were trained to basically take off and not land, and their whole mission was to fly their aircraft into American warships. They were giving their lives for their emperor, who it was said was both God and man. The kamikazes proved to be a very fierce and at times very lethal opponent. Americans found this to be a very difficult threat to fight against, but less like for the Germans and their secret murder and terror weapons, this was unveiled too late, even with all the destruction that they caused.
Why the suicide plane fails 99 times out of 100. The U.S. Navy's accurate fire is enormously effective. Even against the best defense, the enemy sometimes gets through. Scenes aboard the U.S. aircraft carrier Bunker Hill now shown for the first time. Through this terrible ordeal, she lived to fight again. American destroyer hit by four suicide planes. The crew refused to give up the ship and sailed it to the safety of an advanced repair base. Such a base is this huge floating dry dock in the Pacific, one of a number towed in sections thousands of miles out to sea. They make possible speedy repairs on ships right in the fighting zone. With lifting capacities up to 100,000 tons, they can dry dock the largest battle wagons. In a recent 8-month period in the Pacific, they handled 176 ships needing urgent overhaul. A crippled ship can now be repaired and returned to action in the time usually taken to reach home. First aid stations of the fleet. One more reason why the U.S. Navy now rules the Pacific.
That last comment by the commentator, the narrator, why the U.S. Navy now rules the Pacific, at least in 1944 and 1945, As these pictures demonstrate, the United States Navy was definitely on the march. The Japanese were fighting fiercely, but just like Hitler and his murderous regime, the regime of Hideki Tojo and his militarists was coming to a fast close. The U.S. Navy, the U.S. Army, the U.S. Marine Corps were all steaming toward Japan. Battleships, cruisers, destroyers, submarines, aircraft carriers especially. And then on October 20th, 1944, General Douglas MacArthur, seen here wading ashore at Leyte Gulf. 2 years earlier, he had promised the Filipino people when he left, he said, "I shall return." When he got ashore, he found a microphone and a radio, and he broadcast to the Filipino people this message: "People of the Philippines, I have returned." The battle kept going on. Eventually, the Americans attacked Okinawa, Iwo Jima, and on February 23rd, 1945, in this very famous picture by Joe Rosenthal showing US Marines atop Mount Suribachi, Iwo Jima, raising the American flag. The time was getting close. By that summer, the Americans were in a close enough position to send a warning to the Japanese to tell them that we had a secret weapon that would end the war instantly and urging them to surrender. They didn't believe it. So on August 6, 1945, the B-29 bomber named Enola Gay, flown by Colonel Paul Tibbets, dropped an atomic bomb on the city of Hiroshima. 3 days later, another B-29 dropped an atomic bomb on the city of Nagasaki. It was then that the Japanese finally surrendered. On September 2nd, 1945, aboard the USS Missouri, harbor or anchored in Tokyo Bay, the Japanese delegation came aboard the ship. One can only wonder what must have been going through their minds, seeing all those American sailors, those Australians, those New Zealanders, those British warriors on that ship who had fought against them for so long and had been through so much just to get them to this point where they finally surrendered. The surrender ceremony was very solemn, very grim, very necessary, but finally the war was over. You see in the background there, Admiral William F. Bull Halsey, General MacArthur was there, Admiral Nimitz was there. This is General MacArthur signing the surrender document. And then in the picture on the right, you see General MacArthur standing, basically towering over Emperor Hirohito. General MacArthur will go on to become the military governor of Japan. And he'll have a tremendous hand, a tremendous influence in writing the Japanese Constitution. But while all that's going on in Japan, toward the end of World War II, the Soviet Union, our ally against Nazi Germany, they had not been wasting time. As they advanced from east to west, they had been very careful to make sure that as they went through Eastern Europe, everywhere the Red Army, as one of my professors once said, everywhere the Red Army went, it stayed, all the way to Germany. And as you can see from this map, the Red Army will go from clearly, obviously, the Soviet Union into Romania, Bulgaria, Yugoslavia, Hungary, Czechoslovakia, Poland, and of course, Germany. After the war, Germany was divided into occupation zones. And as you can see from this map here, the British had a zone, the US had a zone, the French had a zone, and all that in red, of course, is a Soviet occupied zone. But the interesting thing about the Soviet zone was that inside of the Soviet zone was the capital city of Berlin. And likewise, Berlin itself was divided into a French, British, American, and Russian zone. It seemed like a good idea at the time, but this division and the distrust between the two sides that began to develop very quickly would one day become the scene of some major drama. Another look at how Berlin itself was divided into the Soviet sector, the American sector. On February 9, 1946, think about this. The war had not been over that long, not really. And on February 9th, 1946, Joseph Stalin, the Soviet dictator, gave something at the Bolshoi Theater, which is known as his Bolshoi speech. In that speech, Stalin basically blamed the West for all of Russia's miseries. Now, on the one hand, he wasn't wrong because, after all, Germany was a Western nation. And Russia had been invaded twice in two world wars, even by the United States and the British in the First World War, and by Germany in both wars. So he was technically, he was not wrong as far as the facts were concerned, but Stalin was talking about this from the standpoint of the Western nations had invaded the Soviet Union because it was capitalism trying to destroy communism. And he saw that in the post-war world, this was going to be an ongoing conflict where the Russians had to be very clear about who their enemy was, and that the West would be using capitalism, or that capitalist nations would still never give up their quest to destroy the communist revolution, the Bolshevik revolution that had started in 1917. Well, that speech was heard. Back in Washington, D.C., people at the State Department got a letter. It's called the Long Telegram. As I say, at the State Department, they got a message from this man right here. George Frost Kennan had lived in the Soviet Union for a long time. He was one of the most knowledgeable diplomats in the entire U.S. Foreign Service that knew about Russia. And when he learned about the Bolshoi speech, the summary is this. His summary was, he told his bosses in Washington, Russian leadership was unable to see a long-term coexistence, peaceful coexistence with the West. Kennan said that there was an inherent Russian sense of insecurity, that they felt threatened by the West. He said that the Soviets were deeply suspicious of other nations. He said that they were certain to attempt expanding their sphere of influence beyond what it already was. They already dominated all of Eastern Europe and the Russian Far East. They were looking to take over more of the world. And he said that the Russians were likely to aid people seeking to get from beneath the heels of colonial powers. That would be Britain and France. And he's talking about now that the Soviets were looking at extending their influence into Asia and Africa, those two areas of the world that have been colonized, certainly by, in Africa's case, by so many of the European powers. He also said that the Soviets seemed to be impervious to the logic of reasons, but very sensitive to the logic of force. In other words, the Russians understood force, they understood power, and you could negotiate with them, but at the end of the day, they probably understood tanks and artillery better than they did words. And last, he said, the U.S. and the West will have to resist Soviet attempts to expand. Basically, what George Frost Kennan was saying was that the West was going to have to contain the Russians. And so his recommendation was a thing called containment. Please bear with me as I read this. At the end of World War II, few in the West had experience with the Soviet Union, and even fewer understood what motivated the Soviets, except for George Frost Kennan. In 1946, while he was chargé d'affaires in Moscow, Kennan sent an 8,000-word telegram to the State Department, the now famous Long Telegram, on the aggressive nature of Stalin's foreign policy. He signed it Mr. X. Mr. X published an outline of his philosophy in the prestigious journal Foreign Affairs of 1947. His conclusion was that the main element of any United States policy toward the Soviet Union must be that of a long-term, patient, but firm and vigilant containment of Russian expansive tendencies. That one word, containment, became pretty much the bedrock, the foundation, the cornerstone of whatever other policy America was going to have against the Russians, the Soviet Union, and then eventually the Chinese, or let's put it like this, the communist world from 1945 up until when the Berlin Wall fell in 1989-1990. Not long after Stalin's Bolshoi speech, on March 5th, 1946, Winston Churchill, the very courageous and inspiring leader of Great Britain during World War II, made a trip to Fulton, Missouri. And there he gave what came to be known as his Iron Curtain speech. It was a warning from the British Prime Minister to the West about the new conflict that was already upon them.
From Stettin in the Baltic to Trieste in the Adriatic, an iron curtain has descended across the continent. Behind that line lie all the capitals of the ancient states of Central and Eastern Europe: Warsaw, Berlin, Prague, Vienna, Budapest, Belgrade, Bucharest, and Sofia. to all these famous cities and the populations around them lie in what I must call the Soviet sphere. And all our subjects, in one form or another, not only to Soviet influence, but to a very high and in some cases increasing measure of control from Moscow. There never was a war in history easier to prevent by timely action than the one which had just desolated such great areas of the globe. It could have been prevented, in my belief, without the firing of a single shot. And Germany might be powerful, prosperous, and honored today, but no one would listen.
This was eye-popping, ear-catching information. Winston Churchill not only gives a warning that an Iron Curtain is spread across Europe, that Iron Curtain being made of artillery and tanks and armored vehicles, but he then reminds people of the very recent world war that had just ended, telling them that the war could have been ended without firing a shot if people only had listened to stop Hitler before he had come to power, had met him before they started giving in to him during that season of what they called his bloodless victories. Churchill is warning the West and the United States in particular that another war could possibly break out and that the vigilance that was not there before World War II must be had now to not back a step away. This map right here shows a representation of that Iron Curtain that Churchill was talking about. And you can see, just like he said, Stettin down to Czechoslovakia, Hungary, all the nations of the East were under Soviet domination. For his part, Joseph Stalin responded to Churchill, said, "It may be that some quarters are trying to push into oblivion the sacrifices of the Soviet people, which ensured the liberation of Europe." And again, Stalin wasn't wrong. The Soviet people had suffered tremendously during World War II. That's why he kept on asking for that second front. But Stalin, of course, had his own objectives and his own motives. He goes on to say, "But the Soviet Union cannot forget them, the suffering of the Soviet people. What can be surprising in the fact that the Soviet Union, in a desire to ensure its security for the future, tries to achieve that these countries should have governments whose relation to the Soviet Union are loyal? How can one qualify these peaceful aspirations of the Soviet Union as expansionist tendencies?" From Stalin's point of view, he's saying, "We intend to establish a frontier that will guarantee Soviet safety. And if anybody's going to come through and attack us again, there will be a very high price to pay." He is calling into the memory, the immediate memory, the sacrifice, the millions of deaths of Soviet citizens who just suffered, like I said, so horribly under Nazi attack. The Cold War was already underway. And one instance, one event that will eventually change American foreign policy and cause a test of George Frost Kennan's containment recommendation came in 1947 during what foreign policy experts call the Greek crisis. Put simply, the Greek government was under attack or being threatened by communist insurgents. The British, for a long time, had had the dominant presence in Greece. But after two world wars, the British just didn't have the infrastructural depth, economic depth, the manpower to hang on to their former colonial empire. The Greeks were asking for help. The British were not going to do anything because they had to abandon the project. They just didn't have the wherewithal to do it. And the United States was looking at an expanding Soviet Union that was backing a lot of these elements around the world, trying to destabilize governments. It's one thing to have all of Eastern Europe under the Soviet heel, but now they're moving down into Mediterranean Europe as well. President Truman made a decision that the United States would back the Greek government in helping it stave off a communist takeover. And that's when something happened, when he put out something, or he developed something called the Truman Doctrine on March 12, 1947. The Truman Doctrine, pretty much still keeping as a centerpiece, containment, contained the Soviet Union. But the question was, how do you contain the Soviet Union? Sure, containing them is a good idea, but under what conditions? When are you going to do it? What are you going to use to do it? He said the United States will provide political, military, and economic assistance to all democratic nations under threat from external or internal authoritarian forces. Now, this was a big departure from the history of U.S. foreign policy, because generally speaking, America had gotten involved in wars only when the actual physical United States was threatened or people could interpret it as a threat. But now America is expanding its interest and sphere of influence to say it doesn't matter if it's the actual physical United States. We are now fighting this global anti-communism crusade. We are protecting democracies around the world, and we will provide political, military, and economic assistance to all democratic nations under threat from external or internal authoritarian forces. That sends American foreign policy on a completely different path. And it also opens up the door for some possibilities in Asia as well. The Truman Doctrine reoriented U.S. foreign policy away from its usual stance of withdrawal from regional conflicts, not directly involving the United States, to one of possible intervention in faraway conflicts. That part about usual stance of withdrawal from regional conflicts is especially important for the end of World War II, because at the end of World War II, the United States had 12 million men and women in uniform. And normally what the United States had always done in wars was to demobilize very quickly. Now we're entering into a time where America really can't disarm and demobilize. You're going to have a standing military, which is also a different kind of evolution or development in the United States, because up to this point, Americans had always had something of a tenuous relationship with the military. Our founding fathers did not want us to have a large military. That's why we have a civilian commander in chief, because they wanted to ensure that people in charge of government would never be able to use that military power to destroy this democracy. So the Truman Doctrine was doing a number of different things in the history of the United States, both domestically and with regard to foreign policy. In the meantime, while that's going on back in Greece, in the meantime, there were troubles brewing inside of Germany. The hostilities between the West and the East, meaning the United States and the British and the French and the Russians, was becoming more acute. With Berlin inside of the Soviet zone, what had been going on was that there were people in Eastern Germany and people in Eastern Berlin who had been escaping into West Germany and West Berlin, well, because they wanted freedom. What the Russians decided to do was to blockade Berlin. Deep inside the Soviet zone, if Americans and British and French forces and representatives could not get to the people inside of their zones, inside of the city of Berlin, what was the antidote? What was the solution to reaching people inside their sectors with Berlin so deep inside of the Soviet sector of Germany? The response was a thing called the Berlin Airlift. From June 24th, 1948 to May 12th, 1949, flying usually from Tempelhof Airfield, American and British cargo planes flew round the clock, sometimes landing within moments of each other, round the clock flights, bringing food, medicine, clothing, fuel, whatever the people needed in West Berlin to survive. The Russians were literally trying to starve and freeze people to death, deny them medical help, deny them access to the things that they needed to live day to day. And it was further compounded by the fact that they were living in bombed out buildings. Germany was utterly destroyed by World War II. And now there's this as well. This did not send a good message to the world as far as what the Russians' intentions were. It was a PR disaster. And it clearly removed all doubt that the Russians, the Soviets, were a clear and present danger who, yes, would go so far as to starve a city to death just to make sure that they stayed in charge. The Berlin airlift was a major success. As you get to 1948, though, 1949, America's nuclear monopoly that had barely lasted for 3.5 years. In 1949, the Russians exploded their first atomic device. And then also in 1949, a long-running conflict on the Chinese mainland finally ended when Mao Zedong, the communist leader of the communist Chinese, kicked off the mainland. Chiang Kai-shek and his nationalist forces, also known as the Kuomintang, kicked them onto the island of Formosa. Today we call it Taiwan. And Soon thereafter, Mao Zedong began consolidating power in mainland China, now calling it the People's Republic of China. It wouldn't take long before the difficulties of Europe would transfer on a larger scale to Asia, particularly in a place called Korea, but you all will hear about that later on. For the moment, this was the Cold War. The two Koreas that'll be divided, with the Chinese and Russians backing them, the Americans and Japan, it'll be one of the most dangerous periods in all of human history. Whereas you see from this political cartoon, as those two pieces of paper falling to the chasm go, two powerful nations, both nuclear, with the ability to destroy the world, irresponsible statements, deepening suspicions. It will last for 45, 50 years, and the world will know it as the Cold War. It has been my pleasure to be with you. Thank you.